It was a romance fueled by passion and secrecy. He was a smooth operator with a shady history.
A smooth guy who could say all the right things.
She, a beautiful singer with an angelic voice.
She sang with such grace and passion.
And a soft spot for bad boys.
She didn't want her family to know.
But their affair was cut short when one of them vanished into thin air.
This case was just twisted beyond belief.
Is this a crime of passion or the work of a cold-blooded criminal?
I think he is a sociopath.
He may not have shown his true cards to her. And when she found out, he dealt the big joker. And it was a violent one.
My brother just came to my house and told me that he killed his girlfriend.
Wednesday, June 16th, 2004, 7:25 p.m. It's a humid evening in Spartanburg, South Carolina. On the south side of town, two police officers pull up to an unassuming home in a quiet neighborhood. They're investigating a missing persons report filed by a woman who's been trying to get a hold of her niece for weeks.
Her aunt called in and wanted to perform a welfare check. And when police arrive at the residence, they don't get an answer at the door, so they end up forcing entry into the residence.
When officers set foot inside the home, a powerful stench overwhelms them. In the bedroom, they make a horrifying discovery.
There were dogs that had been there that obviously was pregnant and had puppies, and no one has been there for probably a couple of weeks. They became malnourished, and some of them even died.
It's just a terrible scene to walk into.
When detectives saw the state of the house, that's when they started to take this case very seriously, because they knew that nobody would leave their house or their pet in that state.
170 to dispatch.
But the officers can find no sign of the missing woman, dead or alive. The only thing investigators know for certain is the homeowner's name, Tamika Huston. Raised in South Carolina, Tamika Huston was eager to grab life by the reins.
Tamika was a cute, petite, 4'11", 125-pound dynamo. She had a very outgoing personality. She had a beautiful smile,
full of life, full of life. She loved children, she loved animals. She was just a real people person.
She talked to family members and friends. They said she's one of the nicest people you can meet.
Tamika was also a church-going girl and never missed Sunday service.
Tamika was religious, and she tried to live by the golden rule: do unto others as you would have them do unto you.
Tamika was also the star of the church choir.
She had a very unique sound, and it was a beautiful voice. She sang with such grace and passion.
She loved to sing. Her voice, I mean, just her size, 4'11", I mean, she had a strong voice, very strong voice.
Though it wasn't just her kind heart and heavenly voice that attracted people to Tamika.
She was beautiful on the inside, on the outside. Other people described Tamika as this little short ball of fire. You know, I would hear people constantly talk about how much they loved her. And she was just always so sweet and friendly.
Tamika was in the prime of her life. She was smart and beautiful.
I could definitely see why men would be interested in her. She was very attractive, and she had a very youthful exuberance.
Her inner spirit was just so loving. She never met a stranger. She cared for people.
Friends and family believed Tamika's talent and good looks had her destined for stardom.
Tamika was trying to find herself. She just hadn't really figured out which direction she wanted to go in life professionally. And I think that she was hoping that maybe singing would be something that would lead her to the life she wanted.
As much as Tamika longed to be a professional singer, she was hesitant to leave Spartanburg in order to fulfill that dream. That's because in the summer of 2000, Tamika fell for a handsome bad boy, the rough, tough, and extremely charming Terrance Moss.
I was at my family's convenience store. I came out of the store and I was going to get on my motorcycle, and then she popped up and she said, "Do you have an extra helmet?" So I said, "No, you can wear mine." So I thought she was just joking. So she actually put my helmet on. We went riding and we exchanged numbers and we started a relationship ever since that day.
He had a very large, outgoing personality. He's a bit of a character. Sometimes the way to a woman's heart is if you can make her laugh, you can get in there. I think Terrance made his way into Tamika's heart with giggles and laughs.
Terrance and Tamika's love connection was intense from the get-go.
In the beginning of a relationship, there's always a honeymoon period. And everybody's on their best behavior. There's a lot of positive energy.
It was instant soulmate. Just the love that we shared between each other, you would have thought that we were married. We complimented each other very well.
That positive energy carried over into the bedroom.
Terrance and Tamika pretty much did what young people in their 20s do when they're dating. I think for Terrance, when he hooked up with Tamika, he had kind of gotten a little gem. He gets this beautiful, exotic woman.
She had a big heart and such a small body. That was a great attraction for me.
The sexual chemistry between Tamika and Terrance was undeniable. But apparently, some of Tamika's friends worried Terrance was trouble.
Terrance had had previous involvement with law enforcement and with district attorney's offices, which is more commonly known as a record.
Tamika was willing to overlook Terrance's checkered past, but she feared her family might pressure her to break off the relationship if they ever found out about his criminal record.
So what do you have planned for today?
Nothing really.
Not really? Nothing?
I don't know that Tamika's family knew a whole lot about Terrance and Tamika's relationship because she wasn't really introducing him to all of her friends and family.
But keeping their romance on the down low proved difficult once Terrance moved in with Tamika and her trusty pit bull, Macy.
Well, I'm gonna go out with Gail and Jenny after work, okay? You go out with your friends tonight?
Yeah.
You don't have anything planned during the daytime?
Nah, I'm probably just gonna catch up on some sleep, honestly.
Terrance didn't work a lot. I think that led to some strain in the relationship. Tamika had to get up and go to work every day, pay the bills. There may not have been as much contribution from Terrance.
Terrance's behavior ultimately caused Tamika to question his fidelity.
When people start to not trust their partners, that can lead couples into a very unhealthy dynamic.
Where the hell have you been?
The situation came to a head one night in 2004.
Where the hell have you been?
It's just out with the boys, I told you.
Every night you out. You know, I'm so sick and tired of this.
And Tamika's rage sent Terrance over the edge.
Why are you yelling at me?
An altercation between Terrance and Tamika, and it got ugly.
She was ready to fight, and I snapped back, and I punched her.
I'm not dealing with you,
Look, I run this, you remember that.
The incident prompted Tamika to press charges, and Terrance to move out of the house. But making a clean break from Terrance would prove more difficult than Tamika ever imagined. Especially once Terrance moved into an apartment just a few miles away. But as investigators survey the scene inside Tamika's home, they can't help but wonder, has Tamika skipped town of her own free will? Or has something more sinister transpired? The search for answers will lead investigators into a sordid web of lies, deceit, and the ultimate betrayal. When she met Terrance Moss, 20-year-old Tamika Huston thought she'd found the man of her dreams.
I'm not gonna do this anymore, Terrance!
But Terrance and Tamika's storybook romance had turned out to have a not-so-happy ending.
It was a tumultuous relationship. It was not all smooth sailing.
But Tamika's relationship woes paled in comparison to the horrific discovery police made inside her home in June 2004.
The house was in a state of disrepair. A dog had allegedly eaten one of the puppies.
Hey, little girl. You all right?
And the toilet bowls were empty. I mean, the house was in horrible shape.
She would never, never, ever, ever, she would never leave Macy unattended. She found Macy on the streets, cared for her, nursed her back to health. She loved Macy, and she wouldn't have left her.
Something she treasured and loved very much was dead. It goes from this is unusual to this is probably foul play.
Officer, what do you got?
Moments later, detectives are on the scene. Their first notion is that there's been a home invasion.
Any signs of forced entry?
No signs of forced entry. When we did our search, we did find the purse, though.
Her purse was still in the house, her driver's license, things that a woman normally takes with her when she's leaving home, all of that was still there.
Is that her cell phone?
That phone was with the purse.
Have you had a chance to take a look at it?
No, I have not.
That feeling starts to creep in that something's happened to Tamika. And we hope to God it's not the worst case scenario.
Confusing matters even more is that Tamika's car is nowhere to be found. Was it another clue to this case? Or could Tamika have left town intentionally to start a new life elsewhere?
If things weren't panning out like she expected, she could have easily decided to try to just get a new start and she just left.
Can I take a look around?
Yeah.
But why would Tamika leave town without telling anyone?
I wonder where she could be.
I don't know. Did you notice a car out there beside the ours?
No, I didn't.
Just our car and the cruisers.
Yeah.
Where the person's here.
In this particular case, police are trying to start an investigation 2 weeks after the fact. Lots of leads grow cold. Witnesses forget things. So that definitely creates a problem.
Do you want to locate her car?
There was no car when we got here.
Okay. Have NCIC check and see what kind of vehicle she's got registered to, okay? All right, let me know.
Hoping to unravel this mystery, detectives reach out to family and friends.
So how long have you known Tamika?
Well, we've been friends for a long time.
Most of them have no idea where Tamika might be.
Do you know what happened?
Not exactly. That's what we're here trying to figure out.
But one friend tells police that a few weeks earlier, Tamika came to see her.
I do like red.
Mm-hmm. It's fun. It gives a little bit of pizzazz to it.
While she was there, she received a call.
Hey, I'm just chilling with Nicole. When? Well, give me about 10 minutes. Okay, I'll be there.
All right.
When Tamika hung up, she told her friend she had to run.
What's that about?
Something good.
A few minutes later, a car pulled up outside.
Tamika got in, she waved goodbye to her friend, and they drove off.
Did she get a look at him?
No, I'm sorry. I didn't think to look.
Investigators can't help but wonder if the driver of that car was Tamika's ex, Terrance Moss.
Boyfriends and husbands are persons of interest a high amount of the time because they are the perpetrator a disproportionately high amount of time.
Jealousy and anger can lead people to commit violence against one another. It's led to murders, disappearances, and definitely assaults.
The notion that Terrance might be responsible for Tamika's disappearance gains even more traction when investigators research the domestic assault charges Tamika filed against Terrance. Turns out, they were set to square off in court in a matter of days.
You have a girlfriend and a boyfriend that's having a domestic dispute, so quite naturally, the boyfriend is always the number one suspect.
On June 23rd, detectives bring Terrance down to the station for questioning.
You know Tamika Huston?
Yeah, I know Tamika.
When's the last time you saw her?
A couple weeks ago.
Terrance claims he's been distant from Tamika since she decided to press charges against him.
What happened a couple of weeks ago?
We had had an argument.
An argument, okay. When was the last time you saw Tamika Huston?
I'd already told you a couple weeks ago.
And that's it?
Yes.
And he adamantly said, I did nothing to harm this woman. I loved her. I didn't do anything and I don't know where she is.
Police have their doubts. They grill Terrance about the pending domestic violence charges.
We just got into a fight.
Did you hit her?
Yeah.
And the coincidental timing of Tamika's disappearance.
So why haven't you seen her for 2 weeks?
She took out an assault charge on me.
Yes, you're pretty mad at her right now, aren't you?
No, I love Tamika.
They had some domestic violence issues in the past, but he insisted that he was innocent.
With little cause to hold him, detectives tell Terrance he's free to go.
If you're lying to us, we're going to yank you back in here.
Meanwhile, CSIs process Tamika's house, searching for any physical evidence that might tie Terrance to her disappearance.
Investigators are looking for any evidence of her disappearance or murder. They would search the residence for blood stains, hair, or any other forensics information.
When the police searched, they were unable to find any information connecting Terrance to Tamika's disappearance.
But soon, a shocking phone call will lead detectives to the shores of a nearby lake and lead Tamika's friends and family to fear the worst.
As cold-blooded as you can get.
Okay, what is your name?
I can't tell you that, ma'am, because the police will pick me up.
It's been almost 10 days since Tamika Huston was reported missing. Investigators have discovered that her ex-boyfriend, Terrance Moss, allegedly assaulted her and was due in court the same week Tamika went missing.
That was one of those things that had the police seriously intrigued as to could he have enough motive for her to be gone.
But Terrance is adamant he had nothing to do with Tamika's disappearance. And CSIs can find zero physical evidence linking him to any crime.
There's not really any hard evidence. We can't find where she's gone. We can't find where maybe a crime scene had been located. You don't have any signs of forced entry. There's no forensics evidence. So that doesn't give an investigator a whole lot to go on.
Whenever an adult goes missing, there's always speculation that maybe that person had a secret life. Maybe that person broke character and just departed from everything that they had been and just ran off.
She was a person that loved to just up and leave, you know, but something was different about this time.
If Tamika had tried to put some miles between her and Terrance, she'd need money to do so. Investigators subpoena her credit cards and bank statements, but that only deepens the mystery.
Tamika had last used her debit card 2 days before she was last seen. There was no activity after that date.
Things weren't adding up to a free will vanishing. There was something wrong here, and there was probably something seriously wrong.
Fearing the worst, detectives begin checking local hospitals for any Jane Does that have recently been admitted. They also look to see if there are any 911 calls that could be related to Tamika's disappearance.
This is what I called you guys about.
In doing so, they make a discovery that stops them cold.
Spartanburg 911.
My brother just came to my house, and he told me he killed his girlfriend and put her in Cleveland Park Lake.
Where does your brother live?
He stayed at the park still.
Cleveland Park is located just a few miles from Tamika's home, as are the Barksdale apartments. But those aren't the only details that give investigators a pause.
He said he drowned her because something about he got drunk and she'd been cheating on him.
Okay, what is your name?
I can't tell you that, ma'am, because the police will pick me up.
Is it possible ex-boyfriend Terrance killed Tamika in a jealous rage and then dumped her body in Cleveland Park Lake?
I believe police were looking at Terrance as a possible suspect because there were so many similarities.
Given this startling new information, detectives execute a search of the area around Cleveland Park Lake.
Police officers dispatched cadaver dogs. They checked the shoreline. They even had rescue divers to go down and see if they could recover any bodies in the lake.
They searched the lake several times, and they found nothing.
Then it also
puts the department back to ground zero, not to mention it also leaves the family members and friends still in limbo.
Through it all, Durance Moss maintains he isn't responsible for his ex-lover's mysterious disappearance.
Let them do what they wanted to do. Didn't find anything. I had nothing to hide. Told him thank you, and y'all wasting a lot of time.
Terrence loved Tamika unconditionally.
Still, more than a few people have their doubts about the veracity of Terrence's statement.
It would make sense that Terrence might be involved. They had had a rocky relationship, and sometimes love can make you do crazy things.
With the investigation at a stalemate, Tamika's family decides to take matters into their own hands. They post flyers around town, offering a reward for any information about Tamika.
I've checked woods, I've checked abandoned houses, I've checked lakes, I've checked dumpsters, I've checked landfills. I've been everywhere looking for my daughter.
The flyers trigger a flood of tips. Most are dead ends. But one caller claims to have recently spotted someone matching Tamika's description.
That tip raised hopes that Tamika was still alive and just a missing person.
We really appreciate you taking the time to come in.
No problem, no problem.
Investigators sit down with the man who called in the tip and slide him a photo of Tamika.
Now, you saw one of our flyers, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I definitely saw one of the flyers.
Well, this is our girl here. I'd like to take a look at her.
After police interviewed the man that said he saw a woman matching Tamika's description around town, he said it looked like one of his co-workers.
When I saw the flyer, I just thought, for sure.
But that's not her.
I know a girl looks just like her, but her name's not Tamika.
The tip ended up being a dead end.
With the clock ticking, investigators are beginning to lose hope of ever finding Tamika.
The longer the period is, the less chance of finding evidence or clues. It deteriorates or something may destroy it, or if there's foul play, then the individuals involved may clean up or move the evidence.
But soon, a new tip will come rolling in, and a single turn of a key will unlock the horrible truth about what really happened to Tamika Huston. Tamika Huston thought she'd found true love when she met Terrance Moss. But after a tumultuous relationship ending in a violent confrontation, Tamika filed assault charges against Terrance. Shortly after that, she vanished without a trace. And investigators are struggling to understand what happened.
There's not really any hard evidence. We can't find where she's gone. We can't find where maybe a crime scene had been located.
But investigators are much closer to finding Tamika than they realize. Police dispatchers receive a complaint about an abandoned car at the Barksdale apartment complex near Cleveland Park Lake, the same lake police had searched earlier.
The windows were rolled down. It looked like the car had been parked there several weeks because it had been weathered.
Investigators head over to the Barksdale, where they find an abandoned Honda Civic.
I got here, ran the license plate. It comes back to Tamika Huston.
Our missing girl.
That's her.
An abandoned vehicle. Turns out to match Tamika's car. You wonder if she was abducted, if the person may have dumped the car there. Investigators combed the vehicle. They did not find any kind of evidence of foul play or blood or gunpowder or anything.
They did, however, find a set of car keys that did not go to Tamika's car in the console.
There were two keys that went to a car. Those keys fit Fords made between the 1950s and 1980s. And then there were a couple other keys that looked like they went more to your standard residential type door locks.
Detectives try the keys in every door at the Barksdale apartment complex to no avail. They also interview several residents who provide conflicting accounts.
While police were conducting the canvas of the apartment complex, they found an individual that saw two African-American men abandon the car in the parking lot.
Now, that could have been because the windows were left down. If you leave a car sitting out with the windows down, people who have bad intentions are likely to get in it.
But a second resident reports seeing a single African-American male park the vehicle there a while back. Investigators can't help but wonder if this was the work of their prime suspect, Terrance Moss. Or could someone else have possibly targeted Tamika Huston?
They were looking for anything that might lead them to clues on Tamika's disappearance.
Looking for answers, investigators turn once again to Tamika's friends and family. Speaking to her father, they begin to learn more about Tamika's volatile relationship with her ex-lover, Terrance Moss. Turns out, Tamika wasn't the only woman in Terrance's life.
He was married before he had even started dating Tamika.
According to Tamika's father, Terrance's wife wasn't happy about his relationship with Tamika, and one day she decided to pay her a visit.
This random woman shows up to Tamika's house. Turns out, she's his wife, Jennifer Moss.
Could Jennifer Moss have been so angry about her husband's relationship with Tamika that she murdered her in order to put an end to the affair?
Jennifer Moss allegedly confronted Tamika and said, "I'm going to kill you." She saw Tamika as some kind of threat.
He did have children with his wife. Terrance's children used to spend a lot of time with Tamika, which made Jennifer very angry.
For police, it's a stunning turn of events. They couldn't help but wonder if Jennifer had made good on her threats. But Terrance isn't so sure.
There were so many rumors, untruths, things that people just made up, things that people just pulled out of the sky.
Investigators decide it's time to get some answers. Wasting no time, they track down Jennifer and press her about her alleged threats and Tamika's disappearance.
Did you ever confront her, threaten to kill her?
Absolutely not. No.
Jennifer, did you have anything to do with her disappearance?
No, I did not.
Her and Tamika never had any encounter. That was all just gossip and rumors.
According to Jennifer, after learning he'd shacked up with Tamika, she'd filed for divorce. What's more, she claimed their problems involved much more than infidelity.
He was very violent. He had a temper.
Jennifer and I, you know, had disputes and arguments. She may have had some bad things to say because our marriage ended bad.
According to Jennifer, Terrance simply wasn't worth the effort of attacking Tamika.
When the police talked to Jennifer, my ex-wife, they found that she was not a person of interest. As far as her and Tamika goes, like, no run-ins with each other, no exchanges, that's totally fabricated.
Given the allegations of abuse, coupled with the discovery of Tamika's car, investigators bring Terrance Moss in for another round of questioning.
We brought you back in here. Give you a little chance to think about things. Have you talked to Tamika?
No, I haven't.
You've not seen her or heard from her?
I'm not.
Terrance steadfastly maintains he had nothing to do with Tamika's disappearance.
I was just screaming on the inside. I was like, why won't y'all listen to me? Why won't y'all listen to me?
He was adamant about loving Tamika and adamant that he brought no harm to this girl.
Detectives tossed the keys they recovered from Tamika's car in front of Terrance.
Recognize those?
No. Should I?
They're your keys.
No, I've never seen those before.
In order to verify Terrance's claim, detectives head to his apartment.
They tried this key in every single door, and the keys did not fit.
That's what ultimately turned the tape, was the key to the apartment.
Once again, detectives are unable to tie Terrance to Tamika's disappearance.
Terrance kept saying to me, "I ain't no killer. I ain't no killer. I'm a guy who laughs and jokes around. Yes, I love the ladies, but no, I'm no killer."
He was just an innocent guy who got caught up in a bad situation and was wrongfully accused of something.
Being a person of interest, I had to deal with that for about 15 months. It affected my life, and this is something that I live with every day.
Having reached a dead end in their investigation, detectives decide to retrace their steps. They start again with the keys they found in Tamika's car.
They start going to the different local locksmiths to see if any of them may identify or recognize the key and can maybe give them some other kind of lead of where it would go to.
Finally, a small hardware store recognized the key.
due to a marking that he put on his keys, he's able to look up in his logbooks.
Looked at that key and said, that key goes to the Fremont School apartments.
It was an old schoolhouse that had recently been turned into apartments. I believe there were over 40 apartments.
Hey, how you doing?
Hello.
You're the apartment manager?
I'm the apartment manager. Nice to meet you.
Hi.
Detectives immediately head to the Fremont School apartments and begin the painstaking process of inserting the key into each of the complex's 47 doors.
The investigators secured the area as they went and checked the doors to try to see if they could find the door that the key would work for.
Hours into the search, and investigators have tried 46 locks. None of them are a match.
Almost coming to the end of it, they actually kind of give up hope.
You find anything?
No, didn't fit any of those either.
But when investigators get to the 47th and final door, something miraculous happens.
We got it. This is it.
Just like a scene out of a movie, the key fit into the very last door of the building.
What they find on the other side will lead investigators to the darkness on the edge of town and the brutal truth about what happened to Tamika Huston.
What he did in this case was just twisted beyond belief.
It's now been more than 5 months since 24-year-old Tamika Huston vanished. After running down a slew of dead-end leads, investigators have made a startling discovery. A mysterious key found in Tamika's abandoned car is a match to a door in the Fremont School apartments.
This is a big break in the case. Police will now try to find out who owns this apartment.
But the apartment is completely empty.
Clear.
There was nobody in the apartment when the police got there.
It's empty.
The apartment was actually abandoned.
That's just a little strange.
Was this apartment leased?
Without a warrant, investigators can't formally search the place. They ask the landlord to pull the rental history on apartment 47.
This unit is vacant right now.
Who used to live here?
Chris Hampton.
Investigators are taken aback. They've never heard of anyone named Chris Hampton throughout their extensive investigation.
The fact that there was a Christopher Hampton that did live in the apartment at that particular time throws another person of interest into the case at this point.
This information was shocking to police because before the interview, they didn't know of Chris Hampton's existence.
Tell you what we're gonna do. We're gonna post an officer here at the door, come back with a search warrant and forensics, and really do a thorough search.
Okay.
Detectives run a background check and quickly discover Chris Hampton is no stranger to law enforcement.
Chris Hampton was someone I would characterize as a thug. He was gangster enough to participate in a bank robbery. He was gangster enough to lose his temper at the drop of a hat.
He was a thief, a quiet thief, not a sneaky thief.
When the police actually went searching for this guy named Chris that everyone was talking about, he was in jail.
If Chris Hampton was in jail at the time Tamika went missing, then it's unlikely he had anything to do with her disappearance. However, a closer examination of Chris's records reveal he's only been in jail about 5 months, which means he was a free man at the time Tamika disappeared. So what exactly is his connection to Tamika?
Tamika's family did not know about Chris Hampton. A lot of her, family and friends didn't know about Chris Hampton.
But one of Tamika's close friends reveals that she and Chris had recently started dating.
In Tamika's eyes, Chris Hampton may have been a person that could have protected her from someone like Terrence Moss.
She may have traded the lesser evil. Went with Christopher to get away from Terrence, not knowing what evil she's now getting in bed with. Tamika may have went with Chris thinking that he could give her the safe haven to get away from Terrence, and he would be able to protect her and take care of her.
Police also learned Tamika had met Chris at the end of April 2004, when she and a friend attended his birthday party. From the moment they laid eyes on each other, they had an instant connection. Detectives decide it's time to talk to Chris Hampton.
Mr. Hampton, we need to speak to you about Tamika Huston.
What do y'all want to know?
What was your relationship with her?
Chris explains the relationship in one word.
Sex. It was sex.
Nothing else.
Nothing else.
Chris Hampton was a smooth operator. He could present himself to Tamika Huston as this suave, smooth guy who could say all the right things and do the right things to draw her into his life and make her want to be with him. And yet, the other Chris Hampton that he may not have shown her was a criminal.
It appears Tamika kept the true nature of her budding relationship with Chris a secret from friends and family.
Usually, family members know, your friends know, maybe even the aunt in Florida should have known, but the first time police heard about Chris Hampton's and Tamika Huston's relationship was from him.
When's the last time you saw her?
Investigators ask Chris if he had anything to do with Tamika's disappearance. Chris tells them he last saw Tamika on May 27th, 2004, 18 days before she disappeared.
She came over, she asked me for some money, and that was it.
And you're gonna stick with that's the last time you saw her?
Yeah.
Why were your keys in her car?
Like I said, she came over, she asked me for some money, and that was it. It's the last time I saw her.
To investigators, Chris's claim seems suspicious. On January 10th, 2005, they obtain a warrant to search Chris Hampton's apartment at the Fremont School Complex. A forensic team combs the place. It's not long before they uncover a curious bit of evidence.
They find a bleach stain, and to the naked eye, it just looks like a bleach stain on carpet.
When CSIs darken the room and spray the chemical luminol, they make a ghastly discovery.
It was found that this apartment was covered in blood. That had been cleaned up, obviously. But they went and checked the floorboard and found blood in the subflooring of the apartment.
CSIs collect samples and compare them to DNA collected from Tamika's apartment.
It found that the blood was Tamika's blood. That would definitely move Mr. Hampton to the front of the line as far as suspects go.
But a suspect in what exactly? Detectives still don't know if Tamika is alive or dead.
The blood evidence found at Chris Hampton's apartment would not have been out of place. If she'd spent any time around him and they were in a relationship, it's quite possible that the blood could have gotten there in another way.
The blood evidence is enough to bring formal charges against Chris Hampton.
Based off the evidence, they had enough probable cause to have him arrested.
With charges pending, investigators question Chris again.
All right, so sitting in that cell, did you change your mind?
They confronted him with the evidence they had, obviously the blood that was found in his apartment.
You want to tell us the truth?
That's when Chris Hampton does a surprising about face.
I know what happened.
I guess the guilt had ate him up and he decided to come clean. He admitted that he'd actually been the one that killed Tamika.
We got into a fight. It got heated. And I hit her.
Tell us exactly how it happened.
Hello.
According to Chris, it all began on the afternoon of May 27th, 2004.
Just give me about 10 minutes and I'll be out there. Okay.
After talking to Tamika on the phone, Chris picked her up at her friend's house. And they returned to his apartment, where Chris claims the two then had sex. Later that evening, while Chris was ironing a shirt, Tamika asked to borrow some money.
Baby, can I borrow $200?
You know, I'm gonna pretend like you didn't say that. That's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna pretend like you didn't say that at all.
Pretend like I didn't.
His version is she was asking for money. He made it clear to Tamika he didn't have any money to give to her.
You dare ask me for money when you know I got kids, I got things to take care of?
He was going to provide for a child he had with another woman.
Why do you keep putting your kids and me in?
How dare you tell me that? Listen, this ain't love. This is not a relationship. Stay out of my business. Don't ask me for no money.
You know, you are such a sorry excuse of a man.
And in a flash of anger, he struck her with an iron.
She fell to the ground and I knew she was dead.
How'd you know that?
Yeah, trust me. I could tell.
I'm not sure how one accidentally hit someone with the iron. I think it takes a lot of violent tendencies in order to think about throwing an iron at someone, particularly someone's head.
Why didn't you call an ambulance, somebody to come and try and help her?
I thought it was too late.
Had he done what you're supposed to do in an instance like that, taken her to the emergency room, number one, she may very well be alive, but he didn't. He put her in a closet, then he tried to clean up the crime scene.
After Tamika spent several hours hidden in his closet, Chris says he wrapped her body in a carpet, drove to some woods not far from Cleveland Park Lake, where he buried Tamika's body in a shallow makeshift grave.
It's also shocking that he could just murder her and dump her in a gravesite like common trash. That disturbs me.
You deal with people every day and you think you've heard everything, and something else comes up that just totally shocks you.
I think that Chris just snapped because he was angry with Tamika.
The guilt got to him, and I think it ate him up basically at that point, and he panics.
That evening, Chris Hampton leads investigators to the spot where he claims to have buried Tamika Huston.
For whatever reason, marked the grave with some twigs that he made into a cross.
A team from the coroner's office sets about the grim task of unearthing the body.
They want to make sure they get every piece of evidence they can. They find every bone they possibly can in that crime scene. Unfortunately, they could not find her head. Whether he had told them that he had went back to her body and had really dug it up. He originally thought that he was going to turn himself in, but decided not to. He had took her head and actually put it in a trash bin, and it was not found.
His actions are just so vile that it's hard to even wrap your brain around why somebody would do those kinds of things.
CSIs do find a piece of jawbone, which they cross-reference with Tamika's dental records.
There were dental records that were consistent with Tamika's, but there was also jewelry that was consistent with Tamika's.
You take one life, you hurt many others who love that person. That was the real tragedy. A girl's life was snuffed out in a fit of rage by a guy whose priorities weren't really her.
Her family was holding on to hope. It was painful for them to hear that Tamika's body was found.
Knowing what happened to her, knowing that she was so disrespected even after she was gone, I think that has to be a very hurtful emotion for a family to experience.
Chris Hampton is booked on charges of murder. He maintains Tamika's death was an accident.
It's gonna be hard for him to sell that he didn't mean to kill her. His actions were louder than words. Because his actions showed that he murdered her, meant for her never to be found, and probably would not have been found if it wasn't for the finding out the keys and finding out the DNA in the apartment.
I believe he killed Tamika in cold blood.
He went into a rage and killed me. That's what I feel in my heart.
But with no eyewitnesses to counter Chris's assertions, proving Tamika's death wasn't an accident could be harder than prosecutors imagined. Searching for answers in the Tamika Huston case, detectives have finally uncovered the truth. It seems that in an effort to protect herself from her allegedly abusive ex-boyfriend, Terrance Moss, Tamika found herself in the arms of a lover with an even more violent streak. Career criminal, Chris Hampton.
Tamika, obviously from the pattern that we're starting to see, had an interest in bad boys. And unfortunately, which led her to this violent individual.
When are you gonna make me a priority?
Oh, a priority?
He may not have shown his true cards to her, and when she found out, he dealt the big joker, and it was a violent one.
Chris Hampton maintains Tamika's death was an accident. Prosecutors find Chris's claim dubious, but with no other eyewitnesses to refute his story, a murder conviction is by no means a slam dunk.
it was not necessarily murder. It could have been manslaughter. It could have been self-defense. It could have been an accident.
On April 3rd, 2006, the trial begins. Chris Hampton is led into Spartanburg Circuit Court in shackles. If convicted, Chris could face 30 years to life in prison. But before opening statements begin, Chris Hampton makes a surprise announcement.
He admitted that he killed Tamika Huston with malice aforethought.
He got angry. He meant to kill her, and he basically had an evil heart. I hope he lives that guilt the rest of his life.
Chris didn't really see a way out and felt like it didn't matter. He was going to be punished for it anyway.
Fearful for his life, Chris begs the court for leniency, but the judge shows little mercy.
This particular judge listened to the facts, and he concluded that life without parole was the proper sentence. He will be in prison until he dies.
Even as Chris Hampton is carted off to prison, those closest to Tamika can't help but lament the bizarre chain of events that led to her murder.
I would just want to be able to see the look him in his eyes, in his face. And to tell him, like, you have no idea what you took from this world.
It makes you realize that you really never know people. When I first met Christopher Hampton, I never thought that he would be the reason that Tamika is not here with us today.
You never know who you're sleeping with. Tamika didn't know what Chris was capable of. She hadn't seen the dark side of his personality. And when she finally saw it, it was violent and it was lethal.